Hey everyone, it's Michael Antonovich with Swap Moto Live. The first weekend in July means it's time for a crown jewel of the Pro Motocross Championship, and the Richie family is preparing for a record crowd turnout at the 2024 RedBud Motocross. The extended holiday weekend and the incredible action we've seen through the first five rounds means expectations are high on and off the track, so let's get ready for it with a pre-race news break presented by Yamalube. Independence Day is always the theme at RedBud, and this year it seems like even more teams have gotten into the patriotic spirit with one-off graphics and gear sets that have some sort of red, white, and blue detail. The AMA's entry lists are again near capacity, with 87 competitors signed up for the 250 class and the 90 rider maximum in the 450 class. RedBud's crew has put plenty of work into the property to have it ready for the card-carrying pros and the thousands of amateurs that will do laps around the tracks. Heavy rain on Friday morning and again in the afternoon soaked the sandy loam mix, enough to prompt the cancellation of Moto Two for the Scouting Moto Combine, but overnight ripping and tilling should work in the moisture and have the course ready for the first laps of Saturday's time qualifying sessions. The weather on race day should be perfect, as current forecasts call for clear skies, steady winds, and an afternoon high of 76 degrees. Here's the points for both classes going into the weekend. Hayden Deegan continues his command of the 250 class with 238 points. Chance Hymus is second with 196. Tom Vial third with 195. Levi Kitchen fourth with 177. Joe Shimoda fifth with 174. Ty Masterpool sixth with 146. Pierce Brown seventh with 133. Jalik Swole eighth with 124. Jordan Smith ninth with 112. And Joey Savacci tenth with 111. Although 3 points separate the top three in the 450 class, Jet Lawrence's summer-ending thumb injury will certainly change the tone of the title fight. Hunter Lawrence continues to run the red plate with 213 points. Jet Lawrence and Chase Sexton are tied for second with 210. Justin Cooper is fourth with 176. Aaron Plessinger fifth with 162. Dylan Ferranda sixth with 152. Jason Anderson and Justin Barsha are split for seventh with 148 each. Malcolm Stewart is ninth with 133. And Frederick Noren is 10th with 90. The Scouting Moto Combine was part of Friday's program. The one-day scrimmage gave developing prospects a chance to work with former champions on their racecraft and technique in a race simulation scenario that included two practice sessions and what was supposed to be two motos until the rain stopped the second gate drop. Team Green Kawasaki rider Landon Gordon led all 13 laps until a costly mistake one turn from the finish got him stuck on a berm and allowed a hard-charging Drew Adams to claim the win. Check back for How Was Your Weekend with the Young Racers later on.
Hey, folks.
What's up, mate? You got my 20?
You better be holding it right in your sock.
You know I am.
I know things are tight for you right now, so
exactly.
I'm not going to come at you for that 20.
What's up, Dino?
I've only let you hold it for 11 years now.
I know. You're a nice bloke, you know what I mean? Is there interest in that?
Huh?
Is there interest? Fuck. All right.
I like that he's getting you at the end, too.
I know.
I gave him
$20. Or he gave me $20 literally in 2011, and he won't let it go.
I told him I don't want it back till you retire.
That's it.
So there we are, Loretta Lenz, the young upstart, working on his American accent, but then we knew the Scotsman lurked deep.
Brought it back.
Standing with some young riders and some of the young ladies, and was up at the ice cream stand. Thought he was going to like kind of throw down for it, but had no money. Come to the rescue, Rob, by his good personal friend,
yep.
Lent it to him, and now 15 years later, he owes me $11,428.
Interest went up huge. So he doesn't let that one go. Good lad he is.
Top man.
How we feeling, Dino?
Yeah, so we're here at RedBud. Not feeling great. Unfortunately, I had a pretty big crash at Glen Helen on Tuesday. Of course, last lap of my moto I was doing, and I landed in neutral, and it just scorpioned over the bars and had a huge one. And the body's really, really sore, and that I can deal with, but I injured my wrist, and I don't know really, my wrist hurts, and it's like hard to bend. So I'm hoping it's just sprained. I haven't got an x-ray or anything. So I'm gonna go do press day and see if I can even ride, and then if I can, we'll definitely race. But if I can't, then I can. And that sucks, but it would have been really cool to be out there. Yeah, I still might be out there, so not count myself out yet, but just don't know how my wrist is gonna feel. But obviously it's RedBud, it's the biggest race of the year, 4th of July, all of that. So I really wanna be out there, and I thought this would be a cool national to come do and get some SMX points.
And you knew the team was coming, and you're not gonna do Southwick.
No. So the team was doing Southwick and RedBud, so I was like, hey, count me in for RedBud, but I won't be at Southwick. Definitely not really that prepared for this, but I just, like I said, I need to get some points. I'm hovering in like 15th. A lot of guys have came and passed me because, you know, it's double points every weekend for them. So I've been watching my points. I just don't want to do the LCQ every weekend at SMX. You know, it's like, it's just stressful, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes.
On your program right now, just with where you're at, like how much are you riding during the week? How much are we training? Like, are you just chilling? How much is it?
Yeah, so I usually ride like once or probably twice a week, just in Cali. And so I've been riding a bit, but I was racing in Brazil, Supercross, doing that. That was a lot of fun. And I've been still quite busy, you know, but there's nothing like just actually being in the mix racing nationals every weekend. Like just jumping in for one when you're not exactly like in the shape you should be is definitely going to be tough, but I can suffer pretty good, so we'll see how it goes. Just need this wrist to be okay and we'll be fine.
I love the Dino Around the World Tour. Like I keep telling you that every time you go on a trip. So how was Brazil?
Brazil was awesome. They really treated me good over there. I had a lot of fun. The Factory 100 Brazil team really looked after me well, and the Arena Cross that I did, it's called Arena Cross Brazil. It was really good. It was a fun low track. Some good riders there. Ryan Brees was there, and just had a lot of fun. You know, I'm coming to that stage where I can do all that stuff, and it's fun, and traveling the world, and I still get to race my bike, so I'm enjoying it.
Okay, last question then. That's a long flight. You had that long flight to Oz a couple weeks ago. Are you raw dogging the flight and just watching the map, or are you entertaining yourself?
I've been seeing that on social media, the whole raw dogging the flight. I am not raw dogging the flight, but I tell you who has raw dogged his flights his whole life is my dad. My dad will sit there on a flight to the UK, no iPod, no earbuds, no magazine, no movies. He will just sit there. So I tell you, that man's got some mental strength for sure.
Thanks, Dino. What's up, local?
Locals only.
That's right. How far is this?
It's 4 hours. Yeah, it's a hike to get here.
So you got
to
claim it, though.
Got to. I raced here a lot growing up. It was a local for me.
Did you ever do the grass race?
Never got to.
I want to do that really bad.
Really good.
All right, Marsh, how was the week?
Oh, I had a pretty big get off in Southwick. Just like crunched myself, bike landed on me. Wasn't able to finish Moto Two, so took a few days of recovery, and yeah, we eased back into it. Got a little bit of riding in Wednesday, so we're good to go.
Did you know what was wrong as soon as it happened? Because it took you a second to get up, and I was worried it was your shoulder, it's just road rash.
It was my shoulder. And I was more like internally just crunched, you know, like I felt just my whole insides. I think the wind got knocked out of me, and that was more I was concerned about at the time, but all that kind of like simmered down, and then I was able to get up and walk off.
What day did the paddle mark go away?
It's still there. It's turned into like yellow and purple bruising though. Yeah.
But did you get to ride this week, or did you totally mellow out?
Yeah, so Wednesday I got a chance to ride just Wednesday afternoon. Me and Anthony Rodriguez, we got to ride a little bit.
I like the crew that you've been surrounding yourself with, because you're still in California right now, right?
Got all my stuff in California. I'm still living with Brock Tickle. But I got the opportunity to move to Tallahassee and train with the guys down there, and I just thought I had to jump on it. So I've always been a big believer in like who you surround yourself with is kind of who you become. So I'm trying to latch onto the guys down in Tallahassee and put in the work.
Which part of Tally? Where are we at? Are we at the Go Farm or are we at MTF?
All of it, yeah.
You're doing all of it. Okay.
Yep, working with everybody there.
Okay, sick. You know, I mean, you get to, I really like that about the last couple years for you. You've found different people that you want to learn from.
Yeah.
And you fit really seamlessly wherever you go.
Well, I feel like I do get along with most people, and I'm in a position right now where, you know, I'm not really making a lot of money, and it's tough for me to do it if I can't really afford a facility fee to just be locked into a certain place along with rent and all the other expenses. So I've been doing my best just to like make the best opportunity that I can, and this opportunity came up and I just jumped on it.
I like it. All right, where does Tick finish?
He's a slow warmer upper. I think that showed I go in hell on. So I'd say like 7.4.
Oh!
Don't sleep on the guy.
Thanks, Marsh.
Yeah.
What's up, Phil?
Oh, hanging out. RedBud. Yeah.
I feel that. How's the week?
I was okay. Rode Tuesday, Wednesday a little bit. Did some suspension testing on Wednesday. See how it works this weekend. So it's good. My legs were, I left them at Southwick on Tuesday when I decided to ride. I'm like, fuck. I was hurting still a little bit, but it's all right. We're better now.
At this stage, what are you looking for on suspension? Is this a comfort thing? Is it a speed thing? I'm trying to make the bike better.
Yeah, well, I use a guy named Clint Stapes. He's in California. So, like, it's hard for me because I kind of do mail order stuff a little bit. So it takes a little bit of time to get something figured out. But for what we're doing at the moment, it's been working really good. And after Southwick, I had two different shocks. I raced one shock in one moto, another shock the second moto, and then built another version off of that. And then I tried that on Wednesday, which I'll race this weekend. So yeah, it's always a work in progress, you know, and never stops.
Between that and then calling Jamie on the phone to map the bike,
yeah.
I like that. I like how much trust you have to have in somebody to be willing to do that.
Yeah, no, and I had to talk to Jamie on Wednesday as well. Did some more start map testing and trying to figure some stuff out, trying to hone in on the Hondas, because the Hondas are, you know, next level at the moment. And you know, you still have to be able to go fast when the gate drops too. So it never stops, you know what I mean? Especially for myself, like some guys on the team kind of just go with the flow. But, you know, when you look at the factory teams, you know, like Cowie's got Brock, Honda has Trey, and it's always a work in progress.
Your starts have been good, though. I mean, I see you coming around the first turn pretty far up there last weekend, too, and you know how important that is right now.
Yeah, yeah. It's. I mean, I've always been a good starter my whole career, but, you know, it's a lot easier to start third and work your way back to eighth and ninth versus starting 15th and then trying to get to ninth, you know? So I haven't done much passing this year. I've just been getting passed. But the guys that passed me are all legit guys. And like I said, if I was, you know, 30 and not 35, I'd have a little more spunk, and I think I could be able to finish sixth versus getting ninth. But I still got a couple races to get there, so we'll keep digging.
We'll wrap this up. I saw you went to that steakhouse last week, and you're the low-key foodie. So best thing you've had in the last like 3 weeks, best food?
STK was good on Sunday. I went there after Southwick with a couple friends, and splurged a bit on a steak. So
good you stay today.
No, I flew back to Charlotte.
Oh, it's in
Charlotte.
Okay.
I went to Charlotte. Okay. So my friend Courtney, she was at the Omni, and then like we just kind of had a day downtown Charlotte and just hung out at the pool, and it was fun. I enjoyed it.
Is that the local spot, or is that like a splurge?
It's a splurge, but there's also really good steak local spots in Charlotte. So that was just something that was downtown that we just drove to and hung out with. So I enjoyed it. It's nice because I was able to fly out Saturday night after Southwick. So I was home in my own bed at 11 p.m., woke up at 9 a.m. It was great. So.
Okay, last one, steak cut and color then. How you getting it and then what?
I'm a ribeye guy. You know, I like the fattier type steaks. And medium rare, depends on which way I go. So I tend toward a medium. So if they know what they're doing, medium's dialed.
No sauce or ketchup?
On the steak?
No.
Thank you.
A little bit of butter. You know, I'm good.
What's poppin', Grant? How are you?
Oh, we're good. You're RedBud. Got a sick kit on.
It is sick. You look good.
Yeah.
You've been getting a lot of good kits lately. Did you know this one was coming weeks ahead of time, or is this you pulling out the bag?
Normally Brad will send us like a picture or something like the week of. But obviously being RedBud, like we kind of know ahead of time, like we're going to have the graphics and gear and stuff to go with it, but normally don't see it until the week of.
Okay, so you've been at this a while. You've had a couple different gear brands. You've been an FXR guy for a bit, and I know their 25 stuff is coming out. So how excited are you as a guy this far into your career to still see new styles and everything?
I mean, it's cool. I think I was talking to one of my buddies the other day about it. Like, when FXR first came out, like, some of their colors and, like, design and stuff was, like, way out there. And I feel like now they've come so far. Like, I feel like it's one of the gear brands in the pits where you're, like, you know, like, that's where you want to be. Like, if you can be an FXR, be one of the guys, like, you know, you've made it, so.
Do you still have some of your old stuff? Like, do you ever look at how much the pants or the jerseys have changed to now? Because I have some of my old stuff, and it's wild.
I mean, the gloves, pants, jerseys, all of it. Like, it's come so far, and especially last year, we got some, I know this isn't it, but we got some new material for the jerseys that are super thin, soft, like a lot of holes. That's super cool, so yeah, they've come a long way.
Anything else going on? I mean, how did we feel about RedBud?
I feel like it's middle of the pack race for me. Better than Southwick. That's all that matters.
You're not a sand guy?
I mean,
not a Southwick guy.
I used to be pretty good in the sand. I feel like I've transitioned to hard pack a little bit more. But the last 2 years at Southwick, I've had really bad first motos. And this year's second moto wasn't much better. But I don't know. For whatever reason, I go there and the setup's off. And I don't know. Those guys are just really good there. Especially the Euros that come.
Yeah. Okay, what's your favorite part of this track? Like, favorite obstacle?
Not the leap.
It's not.
No, I hate hitting that thing.
Just the face of it, just the whole bit?
I haven't hit it with the new layout, like with more run up, so I don't know. But like in years past, it's always been out of that left hander, and it's like grab a handful and hope you hit the turn good and don't get passed or something. Like 22, I never hit it the whole weekend on a 450, never hit it. So with the run up, I'm thinking it's going to be a little better, so we'll see. Maybe I'll change my opinion.
We'll find out on Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, or maybe today if we ride. Are we riding? I don't know.
We'll find out.
Yeah, we'll find out. Stay tuned.
All right, Garrett. Came back last week, so how are you feeling?
Last week was definitely a little rough. First round back, I thought I had enough sand riding in me through the 2 weeks I was riding. Well, 3 weeks. First week was just turn track, but felt like I had a decent enough base. We found out after first couple motos, we're definitely struggling with bike setup. That definitely didn't help with energy wise and just burning through my energy tank the first moto. So besides that, I mean, I'm happy with the speed. I feel like the speed's a little better than last year, especially in qualifying. But no, I mean, we just got to figure out the bike setup and we'll be pretty solid.
Okay, so as you know, this has been the year of the thumb injury. You're the first guy to come back from a pretty significant one after some layoff. So for people at home that haven't had one, what is it like to have to regrip it and get everything, and how it feels late in a moto?
It's definitely a unique injury. I mean, I've hurt my thumb in the past, and back in 2019, obviously I was able to ride with it, but this was totally different. I mean, I had to definitely take the first week, taking it easy on the turn track. I mean, heck, I was only able to get 30 to 40 minutes in a day, and then all of a sudden it kind of clicked on outdoors. I was finally able to put my 45 minute to an hour 15 days in. And yeah, it's definitely hard. I mean, definitely at the end of the day of races this past weekend, it's definitely starting to get tired, but it's manageable. It's good enough.
Thoughts on this race?
This weekend, I like RedBud. Hasn't treated me always the best, but last year I had a decent result. Honestly, here is just get off to a good start and yeah, stay consistent.
Thanks, Garrett.
Thank you.
Finally, how excited are you? Because I know everybody else is excited.
You know, I'm looking forward to it. It's been since 21, since I raced a professional race, and then since 20, the COVID year for outdoors. So it's been a while, but I've been over at Kawasaki the whole time test riding since then and help with the development of this new 24 bike. For me, it's just honestly come out, enjoy it. I wanted to race a couple races in race conditions, and with Adam out and the circumstances, I think we're in a good place to do so. I've been training now for about 3 months to prepare. So we'll see, go out and have fun and, you know, see where we stand.
Okay, so when you guys went to North Carolina or to Club MX a couple weeks ago, how did that feel for you? Did that feel different after months and months and months of laps on the West Coast tracks? Like, did you tell, oh, okay, there was a difference here? Or was it a nice little checkup?
Yeah, so the trip, we actually went after Nashville too. So we did a trip after Nashville. We went there, had some stuff to work on. We worked on it. Then after, obviously, High Point, we went there again. And I think we improved on, like I said, from Nashville. So we wanted to go again anyways and do anything we could to get Jason more comfortable and make improvements. And then, honestly, for me, I was uncomfortable. I'll be honest. I was uncomfortable. His cockpit and some of his setup is awkward for me. And then also, the goal for me, it's not what I feel. It's more so to help support him. So the trip necessarily wasn't about how I feel. So in this position, we got the job done. We made some improvements for him, and now we're here.
Okay, so for all the years that you were a racer, and you would leave a practice day, like, thinking of how you were going to tinker with the bike, and knowing how you tinkered with it were going to make your results and how everybody viewed you and your racing career one way, how different is it now to be like, oh, dude, it's just the job to tinker with the bike. I just got to go do that.
Yeah, it's more complex than that, you know? So.
But you don't have the pressure of a public, like, whatever the public sees me do is a direct reflection of all this other stuff going on.
Yes, you know, like, at the end of the day, I think it's about the feedback that we all can collect together and what we do with it. And from my point of view, it makes it easier for the rider, especially just it's hard sometimes. I mean, these guys want to get their motos in, and I understand. Even me, as of recently, I'll be honest, I've been wanting to get motos in, and we've had to test, and we needed the test. So, like, it's about fitting it in, and I'm not a priority to be in race shape. So for me, I'm going to do what I need to do. You know, testing wise, and then also as of recently, I've been doing double duty. So it's been interesting to be on the other side of the fence for this long, and I'm excited to be here. I feel like I've learned a lot being on the other side of the fence, because when you're racing, you don't see that, to be honest. So for me, it's exciting to be here. I'm here to learn again, even more. You know, that's what this is about. I think learning the bike more, learning what it feels like to race again. All those types of traits I'm looking to gain some more knowledge in and take it with me and help others with.
Thanks, Brock.
Yeah.
All right, Jed, good to see you. We've talked a little bit over these last couple weeks, and as we've been talking just now, I like seeing you going through the motions and doing the races and getting the weeks under your belt. So how's it been for all of it? The travel, doing the weekends, doing the Saturdays, practice, qualifying, racing, what's it like?
Yeah, no, I've been enjoying it. Coming back to racing and being here consistently. Being with this team, I really love the atmosphere here, and it's really a lot of fun and very comfortable. I get to fly with the team every weekend since I don't have the rental car, so I'm kind of being carried around, babysitted. But I love hearing the banner and chilling with the boys, and it's just been really fun.
And it's a very diverse group. It's a colorful group that you have in that rental car between, like, you, Phil, Mark, Mike B. Like, there's quite a few people in there to have a good time with.
Yeah, I mean, okay, I'm not with Phil, Phil's on his own, you know, and Marky Mark, you know, he has his parents, but I roll with the mechanics and, you know, roll with Mike B and, you know, team owner Brandon. And yeah, you know, it's a good time though.
So you're deep in it. You're with like,
yeah, no,
guys.
I'm with the crew.
You're going to be putting up the canopy soon too.
Yeah.
Unzipping it. Yeah.
Yeah. I offer to help out. They tell me get lost.
But that's good though, to commit all the way to the program at club, because that's what it takes down there.
Yeah. Yeah, no, we're actually, like, you know, most people say, like, oh, you're a big family, this and that. Like, dude, we actually are at club. Like, we all live at the facility together. You know, we're all neighbors. You know, everyone, you know, you got to get along, because if you don't, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be a hard time. So if you have a problem with someone, you know, you're going to figure it out right then and there, because you're going to see them every day. So I'd say, like, it's just, yeah, it's good vibes. I like it.
Cabin to yourself, or you have a roommate?
No, so I live with Trevin Nelson. Okay. He's on the amateur team, and then also I live with my mechanic. So, but it is a two-story house. I got the whole downstairs to myself, and I got my own shower. I ain't sharing with no one, so pumped on that.
It's the little things.
Yeah, it's the little things, right? So.
Thanks, Chad. How you been, Joe?
What?
How you been?
Living, dude.
Doing it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All right. I'd rather talk to you about the tour, because I know you're a big cycling guy. Even last week when I was watching you warm up, I was like, oh, he's locked in. He's in the Alps in his mind right now. Have you watched it at all?
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, I made Bob turn it on last weekend. It wasn't on when I walked in the RV, and then when I walked back in, it was on, and I said, Bob, you know how to win my heart over. He said, well, I saw you walking in, I figured I'd do you a favor. So today was the old TT, dude, but yeah, I mean, I've been watching it heavy. I'm a big Todd A fan, so he built himself a cushion when he needed to, and yeah, Evan Poole, he curb stomped today in the TT, took some time back, but yeah, I mean, I've been watching it. It's gives me something to do first thing in the morning, and yeah.
What's your favorite part about it? Like, is it?
I mean, I like it just because it's an individual sport, but at the same time, there's so much strategy involved. You know, like, you really got to position yourself in the right spot, and like, have yourself set up to succeed. You know, it's kind of similar to our sport in a way. You know, like, getting off the gate is a big part of it. If you put yourself in a good position to win, you know, your chances of winning go up, and it's the same with there. You know, like, you could be the strongest guy all day long, but if you're not strategic about it and you're not smart enough, you know, you just blow yourself up. So, I mean, yeah, I just, again, I like it because it's, I enjoy cycling and I enjoy the suffer, and I know those guys are bad dudes.
When you're on your bike and it's time to go out and do, you know, 2-4 hours, I don't know, do you guys go that long?
Not really. Off season, we'll crest 2.5-3, but not often. We try to keep it two and below.
Okay. Are you a headphones guy, earplugs guy? You gotta hear it. What do you do?
I usually have one in just for a little bit of background noise, but with Zach, there's a lot of banter on the ride, so he's a little bit bigger than me, so his flat ground speeds is quite impressive. So you know, I know where I gotta sit in, and I know where I could be a little cocky. It's usually the hills, but we don't have too many of those in Claremont, so I try to just play it smart and sit in where I can.
Is he big enough to catch a draft off of?
Oh yeah, he's not tall enough, but you know, if you get down far enough, you get a little bit of a draft, and you need it behind him on the flats. Like I said, boy can push some power.
Okay, where does your mind go when you're out there? Like, what do you think about? Anything, nothing, everything?
Honestly, it depends. It's normally just kind of blanks, but if you start getting in a hurt locker and then things are going tough, it's you tend to venture all over the place. It's good therapy.
Okay, we'll wrap this up talking about Cavs win, because that was major.
I
know you have probably a lot of deep thoughts about it as a guy that has a lot of respect. He's a parent. He's done this a lot. He's went through the ups and downs of a career. What was your takeaway from watching that the other day?
Dude, honestly, like, we were talking about it in the car yesterday, Zach and I, and it was one of those things that, like, I didn't even see him. Like, when they flipped the camera around to the front and, you know, a lot of the guys were starting to make their move, like, I didn't even see Cavendish in the picture. So I was kind of bummed because I felt like he needed to get it then, just because it was, I feel like the longer it builds and the longer it goes before he gets it, the chances don't go down, but in a way it does. And, dude, he came out of nowhere. And when I realized who it was, dude, I was so pumped, because, you know, to see a record be broken is always special. And for him and his story, you know, know, 2 years ago he thought he was done, and I think it was 2 years ago. So to see him do that is pretty badass, to be honest. And yeah, like I said, dude, it wasn't a typical sit in and have your teammates pull you to the front. Like, he had to move around quite a bit, so it was which made it even more impressive.
Last thing, would you rather have the arrow beak or the $1,000 arrow socks?
Socks. The beak, I'm out on the beak, dude. Socks, socks all day.
What's up, Jason? How is it?
Good. Yeah.
Chilling?
Just chilling.
Just another week?
Yep, just another week.
Did you buy fireworks for yesterday? Are you a fireworks guy, or are you mellow?
Honestly, there was enough fireworks on my drive from Chicago here, so I saved my money.
You should have just went to Chicago and watched the fireworks there, in the south part of the city especially.
Yeah.
Real fireworks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How's everything been? Still at club, still doing it. Had the team out there a couple weeks ago. Talked to Tick, and that was a great test for everybody, it sounded like.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it out there. Honestly, Club MX is such a switch up from what I'm normally used to doing, but I'm having a good time, and it's just been fun with the whole crew out there. Everyone seems to ride together, and it's enjoyable.
How's the heat?
The heat the week before South Lake was brutal. It was brutal, but this last week wasn't too bad, and I didn't ride very much this last week, but it's on and off there. Like, Florida was like consistent, like 90, 95, and then there it's either like 102 or it's like 85. So it's you kind of get the best of both worlds.
Okay, so we always hear about how those tracks are and what the differences are, and I've seen the videos of them, and it looks burly. So how is it to go cut laps on that stuff?
I mean, the tracks out there, they have so many different types of tracks. I mean, they have hard pack, they have full deep sand, they have everything. And in my opinion, as far as just track base, it's probably one of the best facilities I've been to get everything that you need. So I think it's awesome.
I asked Marshall this, so I'll ask you this. What's Tick do this weekend?
How's Tick doing this weekend? I think it's going to be tough just to step into racing, but I think he could be, I hope he could go at least like an 8-8. Okay. Yeah.
Marsh said 8-2, so that's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jason.
Yep.
All right, Amy, it's great to see you. Congrats on another big week. Last three videos I've done of these, I got Davey at High Point, I got Keith Johnson last week, so I get to talk to you now about this race. So it's been a fun little streak to see. Yeah. How was the week building up to this one?
Very, very busy. Camping sold out for the first time ever in advance for this event. So it's kind of been a flurry and making plans, and the folks at the Marion County Fairgrounds helped us out and opened up some camping for overflow, so that was cool. And then just opening day, Wednesday's usually a nice kind of slow opening, and it wasn't a slow opening. I guess we should have seen that coming with the holiday, but we had this race with the 4th on Thursday before, and it wasn't like this. So by all indications, it's going to be a really big weekend.
I mean, you can hear it out there, because it sounds like a great rider turnout of just locals that know this is my chance to go ride this weekend.
Yes. Last year we had just under 3,000 entries, but we do 5 events over this weekend for amateurs. So yesterday we had just a practice day. It was 800 entries. I don't know the number for today, but we have a race today on the amateur version of the Pro Track. Then we have 2 night races, tonight, tomorrow night. And then Sunday, the amateurs get the full pro layout with the extra sections. So it's kind of cool. They get to kind of compare their lap times with the pros the day before and get to ride that extra stuff. It's cool.
That's the only time of year that's open for the others, right?
One day a year, a day after the pro race, yep.
Yeah, I can see why. It's beautiful back there. I love the orchard, that big triple uphill.
Oh, it's so pretty. Nice. It's so pretty. It's my favorite part of the track. If I ever got to come watch, I'd sit back there on that hillside and watch.
I've said for like 5 years, I go sit back there the whole time, because you can, from the time they come down that hill until they go over the table and then around that horseshoe curve, yeah, you see it all.
Yeah.
I've been saying since we moved back to Illinois that I want to come do the grass race, so why should I come do the grass race?
The grass race, one of my favorites. It's a throwback. The grass race, I don't know if most people remember, it's old now, but that started out of necessity. On a day when we had a qualifier we had to run, and just amateurs, big amateur crowd, couldn't postpone. We had to run the qualifier, so my dad went out and laid out a track in the grass, and that's how they rode. The track was impassable. and everybody liked it. So we've done it ever since. Yeah.
Okay. You guys do a great job. I know that this is like the crown jewel of the summer. And last week when I was in Southwick and I was talking to just the locals up there of how big of an influence it is on the community, because it's the biggest event that the city has. And I would have to assume, like, yeah, South Bend goes nuts with Notre Dame, but for what you guys do for this entire region of southern Michigan and northern Indiana, it's got to be massive. So how is it for you guys to connect with the community?
It's to the point where we hear it from local businesses. I've had some in town tell me this 4th of July is like their Christmas. It's great. It's great to have everybody benefit. And we like the support for the racers. We like them to be able to have places to go get the things they need and places to go eat and shop. And they do that. A lot of them come, they're self-contained in their motorhomes, but they still need ice and they still need fuel. And sometimes they still want to go out and do something else while they're in town. So it's great.
I see that little hardware store by the railroad tracks, and they always have like the barbecue displays in the window. Yes. And I'm like, I need a barbecue. I want to buy a barbecue.
Hardware store. Yeah. I love that. Yeah, it's cool. It's got the wooden floors, and they've got the dog inside. It's awesome. Yeah.
Okay. We'll wrap this up with this. Again, you guys have one of the most pristine facilities. Everything is perfect. Everybody wants to come here, and you take great pride in that. You and your brother both just know how important it is to have this race. So how is it?
We're very particular people. I would say it borders OCD. We just like things to look neat and nice and run smoothly, and we're kind of crushed if it's not. So that's the way we want it. That's the way we want things when we go somewhere. That's the way we want it when our customers come here. And it can't always be perfect. It's not. Things happen. You have to react to things like weather and just uncontrollable events. But if you have everything prepared right, you can react better. And everybody enjoys it. They might not know why it looks nice. They may not realize that the vendors are all lined up perfectly straight and that, you know, the campsites are painted straight. But you see it and you feel it. And I think it's just part of what makes you think, hey, this place looks pretty cool, you know?
Have a great weekend, Amy.
Thank you.